Okay, welcome to session 5A of the program Making Your Funnel Work, Trial and Lead Generation. Last few weeks we talked about your custom journey mapping and your optimization framework. From your custom journey map, you're going to measurement plan analytics, running your business and your day-to-day things, the most important, implementing your optimizing flow by reporting, automating, optimizing. We talked about conversion rate optimization, because we put it in front because it's quite important. In the first session, we talked a lot about content marketing, creating content for each persona at each stage of the funnel, and we're getting back to it today again. We talked about legal concerning GDPR, always a registered timestamp channel and the reason for the opt-in. So for why people opt-in for which channel, for only your newsletter or your product updates or etc. Talked about Google Analytics and Google Tag Manager. For Google Analytics, use filters in your views, exclude IP addresses and internal users. Use goals to measure critical steps in your customer journey. Also that you can connect back to today, setting up your goals, use UTM tracking parameters to measure your traffic sources, event tracking to measure on-site behavior. That's quite important today. We get back to that when we talk about lead scoring and using segments to slice up the behavior of groups of users. Google Tag Manager. Easy tool to run all your external scripts in one place, implement pixels and scripts without the help of a developer. And in most cases, it will speed up the load time of your website. Then we talked about SEO, on-page, architecture, and technical SEO. Is your CMS up to it to rank your content up in the search engine result pages? Or on top of the search engine result pages, and of course, creating the right content, and the right content only in the sense that you use the right keywords and semantics, but also have multimedia on your pages, use headers, place some outbound links, and focus on UX metrics like how deep people scrolled, how long they were on your site, etc., etc. Of course, link building. Getting on topical authority links from the right websites to your pages. Then we talked a session, I believe, last Monday about app marketing. Like app marketing, you have traffic sources, you send them to your website, from your website to your app store if you don't have direct app store campaigns running. From your app store, after a download, they're starting to use your app, and based on the interaction signals you get from your analytics, you want to send them certain messages. Can be in-app push messages, email messages, sometimes SMS, and at the last, advertising in a form of retargeting. Then we talked about landing page optimization. We went into a deep dive of every element of a landing page, the header, the value proposition, if it's a pricing page, how you communicate your pricing, buttons, videos, and forms, and put in some testimonials and reviews. That having said, today we're going to talk about leads and trials. A small word ahead of this presentation. So in the past, we already talked about content marketing and landing page optimization. After this presentation of today, there will be sessions about lead nurturing and email marketing. So specifically, what you do after the first contact after lead we're going to talk about today, but if it takes, say, longer than 1 or 2 days, you get into a lead nurturing story. And then we're going to talk about that in a separate session. And there will also be a session about conversion and onboarding. So getting someone from a trial to a sale. So we're not going to talk about it today and how to onboard them. And in the last 5-6 weeks sessions, we will talk about retargeting, re-engagement. It's a feature of the ad platforms we're going to talk about: Facebook, Google, LinkedIn, Twitter, etc. So quite a narrow scope today with a lot of stats. Some stats, follow-up, speed, trial tactics, channels, some calculations, and how about lead scoring? Well, I think this is a quite good data set. It's from a research from Converter from 2018. When people of businesses talk about quality of leads, this is one of them, or an important metric, like, do you have a right email address? It's not an Gmail or Hotmail address, but a business email address. Do you have a correct phone? Fake name, I think that's less important than email and phone. But of course, when you really have serious contact and you're making significant time efforts to converting a lead, it's getting strange to have a fake name. B2B demand generation tactics effectiveness. You see two lines. The black line is helping to convert and accelerate leads at middle and late stages of the funnel. And the red one is on top of the funnel, so more inspiration / awareness. And concerning the red line, the awareness and inspiration stage, you see that events and webinars work better according to this slide. Later in the funnel, buyers prefer things like case studies, calculators, etc. Come to that furthermore later on. This is one of the few stats I could find about getting from visits to trials to customers. So it's quite an interesting stat, and I can confirm it with my own experience. So about 2% of the visitors decide to go into a trial, and of those trials running, about 25% you can expect to get a customer from. What's also interesting is if you need to ask for credit card details or any other payment details. This is data from Tutengo. It's quite a big SaaS customer journey platform. They did research. In the left column, a visitor to a free trial sign up conversion. Second row is free trial to paid subscription conversion, so from trial to paid. And how many of the paying customers they retained after 3 months, 90 days. And in the end, you see end-to-end conversion rates, the lowest row, conversion end-to-end 0.6%, 1.2%, and 2%. But you see what requiring payment details does for the conversion rate, getting them into the trials. This was research from a different, I recommend you to read the deep link on the left of Matt Kudu. It's a really nice follow article about when people or users go from a trial to a paid subscription. They did all kinds of verticals and all kinds of journeys and variations in it. And the conclusion says, regardless of model, 80% of SaaS customers converts by approximately 40 days. So there were in this scenarios also 14 days and 30 days trials. It doesn't matter that much. This is a slide about having an outbound sales force calling, responding to inbound leads, and what the conversion rates are. So if you have, for example, if you have a B2B software and you're having, say, about 10 or 20 leads a day, then it matters a lot more than three times as much if you call them or not. An unassisted is, say, a do-it-yourself model. An assist is like you have an outbound agent calling them for, hey, can I help you? What are you looking for? What's your business? What kind of features are you looking for? Because maybe you cannot find it while we do offer it, etc., etc. So it doesn't matter a lot. It does matter a lot if you call your leads. The best practices from trials. Don't ask for credit card details starting your trial. If you want correct email addresses, send them a confirmation email with login link. If you need phone numbers for outbound reasons, send them an SMS code with verification. And this will this is a two sliding sword. Of course, your conversion rate will get lower by asking them to for an SMS code because it's another bottlenecking of funnel. Especially if you have more leads, like more leads than you can handle, or your sales process is running, then your quality of your outbound calls is more important. So you don't want to waste time of your agents focusing on people they cannot reach for one or the other reason. So, we will get to back in a minute that speed is also important. So if you have a phone number, mobile phone number, and you can call them in the session while they're logging into their going through their first trial, that's gold. That's really, you hit gold concerning your first outreach, first contact. Well, call them while they're logged in their first session. A follow-up sequence during the trial period, 14 or 30 days, focus on functionality, features, and integrations, and only when logged in several times during trial and sent upgrading and pricing, sent upgrading and pricing information. So you need to get some signals, hey, they're really into my product for you set the pricing or other information regarding a contract information. So when you automate your journeys, you should think about it. Sometimes serious trials, for example, they've done several logins and done several events like uploading a database or if you have an accounting package, done the first quarter or the first real life data into it, but they're not ready yet to offer to make a decision, offer a trial extension, and not publicly. This in the trial extension should be something like a small gift from your side, so it's not a standard feature of your trial flow. How long do typical B2B sales cycles take? Well, the orange here is new customers, and the blue line are existing customers, and you see the top. It's about at the end of within 3 months for existing customers. Well, for new customers, that's up to 6 months. You will have about 55% of all the new customers will be in. And the others after that period. And this matters for how long you have to nurture your leads. This is research from VanillaSoft and ZoomInfo. You see a link to the slideshare on the left below, the source of the slide. And first contact attempt, response time for web leads and outcomes. So it's quite recent data, I think. And you see that if you don't call them within an hour, the response rates drops significantly. So again, the reason why you have to ask the correct telephone number, preferably a smartphone number. And the second note, one deals had an average of 6 attempts for first contact. You don't see this in this stats, but you do see it on the slides mentioned in the link. So again, the segment one deals, so successful deals had an average of 6 attempts for the first contact. That's a lot, but so you know where you're starting at. Well, just to remind you what the business of lead generation is in, it's a number game in the end, of course also a quality game, but you have to build that into your steps. But for your example, something to really think about in your business, if you get 2 leads per day, which wouldn't be strange, and your efforts close cycle is, for example, 40 days, and you need 2 calls per prospect, or in the example before, 6, and you need on average 2 attempts to have an effective call. In the slide before, it was 6 attempts. Then you can calculate, of course, how many leads you have under management at day 39. And what about day 70? Because still some leads are not deciding within 40 days. Some are deciding after that. And how many calls will you need to be doing per day? That's why you need you automate your flow and think it through thoroughly in front of it, because when you really start advertising and you hit an effective channel or an effective campaign, the leads will start coming in. You don't have time to make mistakes, because else you will be losing a lot of money. Types of leads. It's a little bit about the duplication, which we talked about with content marketing. Of course, you have non-content leads like contact forms, newsletters, subscription, account signups, trials, and requests for quotations or proposals. And you have pure content marketing leads, which are by far at this moment outnumber the non-content leads. And there's a list here of what kind of topics you can offer in exchange for contact information, from webinars, ebooks, templates, tools, white papers, how-to guides, videos, case studies, checklists, worksheets, cheat sheets, tip sheets, FAQ sheets, email courses, calendars, industry reports, research paper, toolkits, web apps, resource lists, calculators, generators, tutorial, and generators, for example, for a law site like fill in some details, some variations, and you they generate your terms and conditions for your website, for example, or your privacy conditions, etc. Tutorials, guides, event tickets, free coaching sessions, etc. What are the most effective tactics used for improving lead generation quality? Social media marketing, email, are important, website personalization. This is from a research from Ascent 2019, and they have a little bit of question that looks like it on the next slide, but it's a little different. which type of content is, this is another research from Ascent, but in I believe June 2020, which type of content is most effective at building relationships to generate leads that convert? You can say video, webinars, and original research and data. Video webinars is close to or how-to videos or trending and informational videos, something like we're doing here today. And other forms of content. What kind of channels do they use for lead generation versus lead nurturing? Of course, email marketing, lead nurturing more, but here also quite effective for lead generation. But depends, of course, if you have your own database with email addresses. Content and video marketing, it's a big, let's say, big word, content marketing, because almost everything's content. This is really interesting. What effect does content personalization have on marketing performance according to B2B leaders worldwide? From say 1.5 years ago. They can improve lead generation a lot, longer times on site, sales conversion rates, and improved opportunity. And the term personalization is really a big word. I will put a note to a database we have put on our website with, I believe, 210 personalization scripts. But you can personalize your customer experience at several levels and through several channels and through several triggers. So I will put a link in the notes where you can find that list. Besides the cases somebody opts out for your communication or your permission due to GDPR stops, so it's not part of the product anymore, you always have to think, what's my next action? Theoretically, you always have a next contact, even with if you have had a client for say 5 or 6 years, but they stopped for one or the other reason. You even have to need a storyline with that kind of users or relationships, like, hey, how do we stay in touch with them and on top of mind that if they decide after 2 or 3 years to come back because our product was superior, that you're still top of mind. So always think, what's the next action? And actually, it should never end. Of course, you have different stages: awareness, evaluation, and conversion. Different kind of content. And you don't always have a permission, certainly not in the awareness stage. But if you do have permission to contact them, you can call them. But maybe that's a little bit early, depends. But if you want to invite them personally for a webinar, for example, that could be something. Or you have an email sequence as an, or if you have an app, notification sequence, but not push, more in-app. Retargeting by ads, of course, and if they're on your website, you can buy pop-ups. You can send them to parts of your content, of your say product journey that you want to let them get them familiar with it, so they learn about your product. Of course, those options you also have in later stages, but after a while, if they are really engaging with your content. So you see them showing up a few times in your database. Like, hey, they now download the white paper. They attended the event. They visited your pricing page a few times. Well, that's really a hot prospect, and you want to offer them. You want to have them on a call for a real life demo, or to make a better relationship. So there's not one way out here. It's like learning and setting it up and experimenting, so you know, hey, this is our right sequence through that channel. Lead scoring. Why lead scoring? Identify at which stage each contact or deal is. Identify high value prospects. Well, how does it work? You can reverse engineer from past conversions their interactions with your channels and content. If you don't have enough conversions or data, if you don't haven't set up your Google Analytics in the right way, you don't have, for example, event tracking for video views, calls, etc., so you don't know actually what they're doing on your website while you have great content, then you just have to make assumptions like, okay, what do a prospect have to do at least before they are ready to be contacted by us? Because you don't want to lose time and precious resources to low chance leads. That's why you put up a lead scoring model. Best practices, different models for different services products. Use negative scoring, so it's not only an up way, but also if people don't open your emails anymore after a few times, well, maybe they've made a decision for buying a product. Of course, set up alerts to sales or outbound outbound sales force when prospecting, getting to certain levels of points or scores. Requirements, like I said already, you have to need to set up analytics and tracking, and you need an integration with your CRM. Well, here are some theoretical models how this would really work. Visit the pricing page, download the ebook, open email, watch your webinar, conduct a site search, etc. Or depending, you have other data for from LinkedIn lead forms or other channels, how you can get buy data from B2B decision makers. And you said, hey, how big is their business? What is their role? Etc. All kinds of things, ingredients on which you can give points. This is a really nice overview, like, hey, what did they do? Checklist website, watch demo, etc. Request a trial. And again, when is this important? Of course, not in your first 10 or 20 leads, but in the calculation example, if you're running a few leads per day for a few weeks or months, you will see like, okay, and it's converting in some way, so you also get the funding to finance, keep financing this new flow.